Much of an opportunity to be in the place where so much prayer has gone up. I wish I could explain to everybody here with a complete understanding how important prayer is. You know, the Bible says pray without ceasing. And people don't take that as one of the commandments, but it is. It's a direct commandment to pray without ceasing. You would not imagine the kind of things that would start to happen in your life if you would start to pray every moment of the day. I can tell you that throughout these services, when I was in Jacksonville with Brother Barnhill, I learned how to pray. And I learned how to pray often and much. And it was one of the best things that ever changed my life. Because I was a Christian, I was doing fine as far as I knew. But I knew there was something yet more. I knew there was something I needed. And I asked the Lord many times, I'd say, I don't even know what I need, Lord. I read your Bible. I've been to church. I don't know what you want me to do. But Jesus was faithful to me, even through those times, to try and nudge me along until the time that I could receive the understanding of how prayer makes a difference. And let me tell you, brothers and sisters, you can't just pray a little bit and be done with it. And I'm not saying it's not good to pray a little bit every once in a while. But I'm saying you cannot expect for God to move when all you're doing is praying, you know, Lord bless this food, thank you Lord for this food, and give us this day our daily bread in the name of Jesus, amen. You can't do that and expect the Lord to hear that. I heard a testimony from a man who saw in the spiritual realm a vision of how prayer actually comes up from the saints. And I brought it to Brother Barnhill's attention, and he has asked me for a tape of this. The man in the vision saw that the prayers of the average person that didn't want to get rid of sin in their lives, all prayer came up like smoke. But this prayer that the Christian that was not willing to deal with their sin would pray, would come up and it would just kind of hover a little bit and just waft away with the breeze. Just like you'd see steam coming up and just disappearing off into the air. He said, but the people who would be willing to deal with their sins, their prayers would come up to higher. They would go higher. And they would be touching the black cloud that the devil has put over this nation. And that if a person at that point would endure in prayer, would continue in prayer, would keep on going and be persevering in prayer, that a spark would ignite that cloud of smoke, of prayers, and it would change immediately into a ball of fire that was so hot that it would melt through that black cloud that's above us. Ladies and gentlemen, I don't know if you understand what this man saw in the spiritual realm, but it's been spoken of by many men and many prophets. There is a dark cloud that Brother Terrell has seen across this nation. And wherever the devil has an opportunity, he wants to block your prayers from getting to heaven. And if you're just praying a little prayer every once in a while, you're starting out that first way, you're not getting anywhere with your prayers. Your prayers aren't even being heard by God. Because the Bible explains, it says, your prayers are not being heard because your iniquities have separated you from God. That's your first type. The first thing you've got to do is get rid of your iniquities. After you get rid of your iniquities, then you have to persevere in prayer. Pray always. Now, ladies and gentlemen, I don't know why the Lord has me telling you this, except that it's something of importance, but I know the Spirit of God is instructing me to teach you this little thing. God willing, I'll get to the end. But when you persevere in prayer, you actually create a hole in that black cloud above us that walks with you as you continue in prayer. It goes with you. And that Spirit of God, that glory, that anointing, the same as it was with the children of Israel. They had a cloud by day and a fire by night, a pillar of fire. That same pillar of fire is with you wherever you go. And when you walk into a person's presence, those demonic chains that have had them bound are weakened. And you have the opportunity so easily to bring them to Jesus Christ. If you've ever been to some place and tried to get somebody to pray the sinner's prayer with you and you've hit resistance and you don't know why it's so hard sometimes to get people saved, this is your answer. This is how you get people saved. Hallelujah. You pray. You pray always. You pray without ceasing. You persevere in prayer. And when you get that hole in the heavens, you don't let it get closed up again by distractions, by the telephone ringing, by people talking to you, by pain in your body, and by stomach pains and hunger. You don't let it get closed up again. You don't get distracted from your prayer. If you get distracted, you go right back to it. You go and pray again, because that's the way you get souls saved. That's the way you get miracles. It's no strange thing, fellow Christians. It's no strange thing. Every Christian should be able to carry the power of God with them. Every single one of you has the capability. I'm telling you in the Spirit, every one of you has the capacity to be on fire for God. But you've got to reach up into the heavens and get that fire. You've got to pray until it comes down from heaven. But when you've got it, you keep it. And you keep going in prayer. And wherever you go, you can be walking up and down the road. You just pray a little as you go. Wherever you go, you pray. And God will change the things around you. It won't be, let's wait till Brother Barnhill comes and he'll pray for you and you'll get a miracle. It won't be that. It won't be, let's wait for Brother Terrell to come to the town. I know he's got the power of God with him. It'll be, I've got the power of God. And you're going to be healed because I say so in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Be made whole. And people will leap up and be whole. Thank you, Jesus.
Amen. Come on, let's give the Lord a good old hand clap. Amen. I tell you, boy, I tell you, we're going to get this thing right. And boy, that devil's going to have to go. I appreciate that service last night. Boy, I tell you, them kind of service right there, boy, the devil don't like them kind of service. I tried to pray, and I just get to weigh yourself out. But how many, when you come to revival, that's what it means, to revive that spirit in you, then praise God, you just summer in you about just want to pray. You just be riding on the road, and all of a sudden the Spirit hits you, amen, and you just go to, and you know, some people think prayer is just, Lord, my name is Jim, but prayer is just communicating with God, thanking God, hallelujah. Prayer sometimes is just saying, oh, how great thou art. It's in relationship with God. It's in communion with God. That's what they all, Lord, I need this and I need that, but good God Almighty, Lord, I ain't just coming out. I just come to say, I love you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Give you praise on your job, hallelujah. I give you praise down the road. Thank you, Jesus. Never lose that contact. Amen. God has got something for us here tonight. I believe Brother Brant is going to come and take us further.
Brother Barnhill is getting ready to come and take us on into the service tonight. Hallelujah. How many appreciates this revival? How many appreciates this man of God coming out and sacrificing? He's been here all day. He hasn't left the ground. Praying, laying there, seeking God. I mean, appreciates that. He's not looking for, you know, to be lifted up. But the Bible said a workman's what? Worthy. Amen. He's worthy. So he's a man that is doing what he's talking about. He's not just up here preaching something and then doing something else. So tonight I encourage you, please, please get behind him with your support. With your support so that we can take this tent to another city and reach more souls. Ask you some time, if you would you stand to your feet with us and reach your hands this way and go before us, the Lord in prayers, and receive God's servant, Brother Autry Barnhill.
Jesus, tonight, Lord, we want to take out a moment to thank you, Lord, for another day that you've allowed us to be upon this earth. Lord, another day that we can, Lord, spend here, Lord, striving to do something for you, to get a soul saved, Lord, to get somebody healed. Lord, it's not us that doeth the work, but it's the Father that worketh through us. Lord, I remember, Lord, that time you told them, the Father worketh and I work. Lord, we know that there's nothing good about us. You told that rich young ruler when he said, good master, and you stopped him and said, there's nothing good. Lord, we know it's you. God, we're just, Lord, the vessel. We don't want to be a vessel under dishonor, but Lord, we all here tonight want to be vessels under honor, Lord, meet, fit. God, I wonder, Lord, if I'm even fit for your use, Lord. God, but make me fit, Lord, for your use, Lord. God, that you can use me, Lord. And all my brothers and sisters here that, Lord, need a little whittling off of things, Lord. God, one man in the Bible, Lord, Lord, you dealt with him about that old potter. God, being put back on that potter's wheel. Lord, vessel, Lord, was marred. You didn't throw it away, but you remade it. Lord, if I need remaking, then remake me, Jesus. Oh, Father, and I pray tonight, Jesus, that you would, God, bless all the ones here that came, Lord, their families, their children, their grandyoungins, their brothers and sisters, mom and dad, if they don't know the Lord, that you would save them. God, that you bless them with, Lord, prosperity, Lord, the things they have need, and God bless them with their health. Lord, don't let there be a sickness among us. Lord, don't let there be a feeble one among us, Lord. That time, God, we read, Lord, out of Psalms that, Lord, it was 3.5 million. There wasn't a feeble one among them. Lord, and you brought them forth with silver and gold. Lord, that silver wasn't to get out there and be luxury. And God, it was to build that temple. And Lord, we know if you bless us tonight, God, when you do bless us, it ain't for us. Lord, it's for the temple, for your work, Lord. God, I pray all these petitions here, Lord, that you would, God, move for them, Jesus. Oh, God, help them, Lord. God, this one here, God, move in this stroke situation. God, Lord, and grandchildren, children, all their family members, Lord, God, you'd move for them, Jesus. Oh, God, Lord, move, God, this one. God, move in these debt situations. Lord, you tell us to owe no man nothing, Lord, but you. God, we owe nobody nothing but love. Lord, we're debtors to you, Lord. God, but Lord, we pray right now, Jesus, that you would, oh, God, Lord, help us to, Lord, owe everybody love, but to get out of debt. Everybody needs to get out of debt. Just raise your hand right now. Lord, everybody's got their hand raised. Old people, finances or banks or mortgages or loans or car payments. Lord, help them to get out of debt. Lord, God, you know how to pay them off. Lord, ain't nothing too hard for you, Jesus. Lord, and all these here, Lord, we pray, Jesus. Oh, God, give life. Jesus, bring life back in, Father. Lord, God, oh, mastering. Lord, move in this situation, Lord. God, help us to grow. God, that's my request, too. I want to get stronger in you. Lord, you tell us to be strong in you. God, Lord, the power of your might. Lord, move. Oh, God, Lord, in this helper, Lord. God, this light situation, Jesus, and all these requests, Lord, we ask it today, Lord, that you would, God, move in them, answer every one of them, and do it speedily. Do that quick work, Lord. God, all these requests has come in, Lord, these last couple, 3 nights, Lord, we pray, Lord, that every one of them, Lord, to be answered. Don't let a one of them go, God, unanswered, Lord. Oh, Father, and we'll be careful to glorify you and praise you, Jesus, because you're a good God. Reach over and take somebody's hand before you being seated and tell them Jesus loves me and you both the same. That's right, you know. Ain't you glad he tells us over in the book of Acts that God ain't no respecter of person? Man, ain't that good? Hallelujah. You know, I was thinking about them servants that went out there, and the master, you know, the man agreed to give them a penny a day. And he went back out there a few hours later and hired some more. And went back out there at the 11th hour, 1 hour, and hired a bunch more. And asked them, what are they doing sitting here all day idle? You know, if you ain't doing nothing for God, I'm asking you, why are you sitting around idle? Hallelujah. That's right. This ain't no time to be idle, is it? Y'all remember them Matthews over at them foolish virgins? You know, they didn't get no oil, did they? And the cry of the bridegroom comes, said, go meet him. I believe that's what God's trying to do right now, get some of us to go meet him. Some of us think that's that time when we're going to be caught up. I don't know. It could be, but I'm using it right now. Amen. And the Bible said they told them wise virgins, said, give us of your oil. Our lamps had gone out. How many of you know they said, I'm sorry, I ain't got enough for me and you both. Go buy and get your son. Buy your son. The Bible said, while they went, the bridegroom came, opened that door and called them. And then the door was shut. Them foolish virgins couldn't get in. Lord have mercy. I sure don't want God to shut no door on me. How many of you want to make it in? Man, I tell you, that's my heart's desire. And I want to get in on into what God is. God is God. I thank you, Lord, that He's got something. You know, the Bible said the eyes not seen, the ears not heard, hadn't even entered into the heart of man the things that God got prepared for us. How many of you know that? Man, God got some things prepared for us that no other generation since Jesus has ever saw. You say, what are you talking about? Well, He said there in Revelations that in the days of the voice of the seventh angel, the mystery of God, that things have been hid from the foundation of the world, things have been hid from Paul. Paul said, I didn't comprehend it. I didn't attain it all. He got more than all of us put together. Amen. Man, where would we be if we hadn't had somebody to tell us about when Jesus is going to come back? If the sound of that last trump, of course, somebody thinks it's Gable up there blowing a trumpet, but that's about the dumbest. I ain't heard the first trump yet. But if that's the last trump, there's got to be more and more. He ain't talking about no Gable up there blowing a horn. He's talking about that seventh trump messenger over in Revelation thing. Sound the last trump. The dead in Christ gonna rise, and then we which are alive and remain. Hallelujah. Gonna be called up together to meet the Lord in the air. I tell you, I ate a lot there, and I'm asking God all the time, Lord. You know, I had Paul one time to visit me and rebuke me because I was praying for a revelation and a knowledge. And he rebuked me and said, I never prayed for one. I never asked for a vision. I never asked for a revelation. I mean, just like I'm talking to you, you talk to me in my left ear. And he said, I said, without a doubt, I'm going to come into him. Since that time, I quit asking God for revelation, knowledge, and vision. Because if you get in that place you're supposed to be, they're going to be there anyway. How many of you know what I'm talking about? And he didn't say it in a nice way. It was a rebuking way. And there's been a many a time that I've thought, appreciate that, brother. There's been a many a time that I thought, Lord, I'd like to, you know, to have something I could one day go up to Paul and say, Paul, I got what you didn't get. I wouldn't do it, Paul. I'm sorry. I ain't in heaven yet. I ain't got that purity heart. Hallelujah. I didn't mean that in a bad way. I don't even come down here, you know. But there's things yet that have been hid. And we've all heard Brother Terrell talk about how we'll know that when this happens and this, well, I've heard him say it on tapes. We've listened to one a while back. When this man does come on the scene, that he'll be able to open up his seven seals that have been hid. Hallelujah. The Bible said he told John to shut them up, didn't he? Seal them up till the end of the time. And I believe it is getting, well, he can't come back until everything that he's got written there has been fulfilled. Hallelujah. And I just want to be part of whatever God is doing in these last days to get myself in a place. But then to get in there, you can't have it or can't receive it through what? A natural mind. And then when the natural mind gets sinful, then God calls it carnality. And the carnal mind, it don't know the things that be of God. And God even said, the mind of God and the mind of carnal are enemies.
Right.
Didn't he say that?
Oh, man.
They're enemies. And God don't like that carnal mind. There ain't nothing wrong with a natural mind. That's what Adam had. God gave him a natural mind. But it become carnal when he partook of that tree, didn't he? Of knowledge and good and evil. Hallelujah. I tell you, I'm trying every day to eat of that tree of life. Hallelujah. In the midst of the paradise of God. I don't believe it's no... Somebody said, well, is that an apple tree or a pear tree or a peach tree? What kind of tree is it? I tell you what kind of tree it was, is. Hallelujah. It was on Golgotha Hill 2,000 years ago and had some fruit on it. How many of you know what I'm talking about? Hallelujah. And that fruit was Jesus. And that's why you can't understand him if you don't know him. And Jesus said, eat my flesh and drink my blood. That bunch said, how can we eat him? We can't eat his flesh.
Right.
He wasn't talking about the natural man, was he?
Right.
He talking about eating that spiritual flesh. Hallelujah. And I try to, you know, Jesus said, your father did eat man in the wilderness, ain't dead, but I'm the true bread. I come down from heaven. Hallelujah. And whoever eats of me, they'll live. Man, I tell you, you know, when you are what you eat, you eat all that junk food. It won't be long before you'll be getting sick.
Right.
I got real quiet.
Right.
Yeah, anybody just don't believe me, go down and get you a VCR called Super Size Me. Anybody ever seen it?
Yeah.
You see it?
Yeah, I saw it.
Man was in perfect health. Health guy. 30 days he didn't do nothing eat but McDonald's food. Nothing but McDonald's. At the end of 30 days, his organs was messing up, all blowed up, stiff joints, hurting everything, going crazy. Hallelujah. And he got right back off of it and got back on health food, and his health come right back.
Oh,
yeah. Hallelujah. And I said that to compare with the spiritual. And you can't sit in front of them things they call, what do you call them? Most of y'all got three or four of them in your house.
Television.
There you go. Somebody said they're even putting them in the bathroom where they sit on the stool and watch it. Got them hanging up. And then you walk in Walmart, them buildings be $500, $600, and $700. Then they take up the whole side of a wall. Used to have a little lady, she's still up there, but she don't sing it. She used to sing a TV song. But like this. TV, television, you can see them now. Everywhere you go, TV, television, move the family altar, put in a TV show. Man, when I was a little boy coming up, even in the Pentecostals and Assemblies of God, if a preacher had a TV in their house, they was, man, you didn't go to that church. And they couldn't hide it because they had to have them antennas up there. Nowadays, you can hide it. Just get your little, I don't even know if you have to have a cord going anywhere now, do you? You got to have a cord, some of this modern equipment, probably satellite. Hallelujah. Well, that's enough of that. I'll have y'all hating me. Hallelujah. Hey, very many churches revivals I ain't went. I'm trying to say, Lord, listen to me. Let me preach one without preaching against them devils. Hallelujah, because I know they'll hook you.
Yeah.
That's right. I was a young teenager, and I went to work with Brother Terrell, and come and I lived from the time that I was born that I remember until I left home without a TV in the house. So it can be done. I'm still alive. Still kicking. But I come home that fall. My two sisters had got married. They moved out, and I left home and come back that fall, and I walked in the house and looked over to the left beside the wood stove, and Lord, I saw two horns sticking up on top of a box. I said, my God, Mama, you and Daddy done backslid. Daddy said, all y'all left, I need a little something to do. I thought, man, you ought to have been praying. Hallelujah. That's right. Bought him a TV. And you know what? You can believe us or not. I was walking in the bed, fixing to go to bed that night. And I thought, well, I'll just check it out. And some black-headed girl on there by the name of Marie Osmond. Man, she wasn't pretty. And you know what? I said, I'm going to just sit down here and watch her for a few minutes. You know what? About a week later, I was still watching that devil. They say cigarettes is addictive and beer is addictive. Well, them boogers is addictive. I mean, I had to do some heavy-duty praying to break loose. And still right now, I guarantee I could sit down for an hour or two and watch it. And I guarantee I'd get hooked again. I doubt I'll watch an hour TV a year. Hallelujah, because I know I had to, you know, I had to flee the very appearance of evil. But man, that thing gets a hold of me and I'll be wanting. I went over to my daughter's house about 6 months ago. I hadn't seen him in a long time. She said, Daddy, watch this movie with me. It wasn't a movie. It was like a one of them, you know, the true thing. She wanted me to see it. But this famous guy. You know, I sat down there and after about 15 minutes, a lady come walking out in a bikini, in a pair of bikinis, you know, and I said, I got to go. They didn't think nothing about it. Man, I tell you, we're living in a crazy generation, folks. Somebody bound up with TV tonight. Hallelujah. I'm trying to get away from this, but it's all right if you need a little help. Them things, don't tell me they're not addictive. I done been hooked on that booger. I mean, I lived a whole lifetime. I remember I'd go with my cousin sometime, and I did like to watch old Ironside. But man, he'd been losing that case, and right there at the end, somebody bring a gun or something in there and let him win it. He never lost a case. I said, Lord, that's what we need right now, Ironside to come on the scene to bring a piece of ammunition or something in here to let this turn this case around. How many of you know right now, hallelujah, look like America ain't gonna have revival in the world, but if God can have somebody to step in here and turn this thing around, we'll get things changed. How many of you know we need a change, folk? Hallelujah. I was praying today, I said, God, send that Elijah man in here. That's what we need. Hallelujah. But you know, first thing Elijah done, got them altars repaired. Restored them altars. That's what we need to get done today, is get some altars restored. He said, you bunch of Baal, y'all done broke down the altars, and he repaired them altars and got down, and God sent that fire down and burned it up and consumed the water and everything else. And it caused them people to change their mind. Hallelujah. Tore down the family altar and put in a TV show. I was in, Brother Terrell stood around in 1998, turned around, told me to go to a city and revival was going to break out. So I did. I went back, went on a 40-day fast. And I was going to break it on the 40th day. And my wife had a dream that I was supposed to go longer. Man, I could have put a sock in her mouth. That's one time I felt like choking her to death. That was one of them days you used to fast, you know, and you didn't eat a piece of popcorn. It was either water or nothing. How many of you remember them fast days? I remember one time I went on a popcorn fast. I'm just going to tell y'all the truth. And they about set a convenience store around the area where I live. And about 2 weeks after I got into it, I went to a convenience store and I bought all the popcorn and went to another and went to the third one. And the lady said, you know, everybody's calling around, all the popcorn's getting going around here. We can't figure out what's going on. I'm telling y'all, it's God's truth. I was eating 7-8 bags a day. Supposed to be fast. I just backed out there, didn't say a word, and took off. I thought, who is that nut eating all that popcorn? Hallelujah. Man, I've done it all. One time I was trying to get in a fast, man, I was having some trouble, and I went to the health food store, and I said, I'm going to get me something to help me. went up there and got me a bottle of vitamins, and it said food enchantment. I thought that mean, you know, to help you not to get hungry, but enchantment mean to get more hungry. I'm from Alabama. I took that whole bottle of vitamins trying to help myself. I said, Lord, I'm getting, there's something wrong. And I went and checked out back to find out what was going on. That lady said, no, that means help you eat. I thought, how stupid can you get? You name it, I've done it. Hallelujah. You know, I did. I went on that, and I was fixing to break it. And I went 5 more days, and that was the first time that I've had, you know, the Bible said when Jesus' fast was ended, his hungerness returned. Most of us don't never fast long enough to let our hungerness return. And they called me to go pray for a man, a lady. And I was on my way, Brother Cole was taking me down there. And I was on my way to the hospital. And man, all of a sudden, I preached that night. We rented a theater, and I was preaching that night, and my stomach just started growling. Y'all, anybody ever had the real hungerness to come back? Not break it yourself? And my mouth started filling up with salt. And I got upset and called the because they had done been threatening they was going to put some salt water in my drinking water, you know, to help me to, because they were some of them worried about me. And I called them, I said, did y'all mess up? Did y'all put some stuff in there? They said, Brother Barnhill, we promised we did. But you know what? I left there, went back, and I told Brother Cole, I said, if it's God, I'll wait and eat in the morning. Done made it 45 days now, ain't done nothing but drunk a lot of water. I said, and you know what? I went and ate, and I was parked up on the mountain up there, and he dropped me off, didn't have no vehicle. And man, about 3 o'clock in the morning, my stomach sounded like a, Lord have mercy, growling, salt was pouring out of my mouth. I thought, Lord, I can't take this no more. Man, I went in the bottom of that refrigerator and there's a big old head of cabbage in there. Been there for 45 days. I ain't ever sticking piece of it. Got through with it and I thought, Lord, I still am hungry. Hallelujah. And I got to digging through that old camper and found a box of pecans. I shelled and every man, a big old box like that. I ate every one of them pecans and I didn't have not one bellyache. Man, most time pecans, you eat that many, they'll give you a bellyache anyway. Hallelujah. But I found out what the real hungerness returned. Hallelujah. I'm telling you right now, went in revival and stayed there 7 months. At the third 3.5 months, I told him, I said, take the tent down. I'm starting in a theater, moved to a tent. And after 3.5 months, I told him, I said, I'm tired. Shut this thing down. They took the tent down, and a voice spoke to me and said, I'm not through yet. I said, put it back up. They put that booger back up and we stayed another 3.5 months. I went back on another 40-day fast. On the 40th day, went in there and laid down one evening in the camper. Went into a trance and an audible voice come through the ceiling and said, the spirit of revival will leave. We'd had revival every night. I had a man before God in heaven. I got his pictures and Sister Sandy got him. Wore a blood cross. He come up, got saved that night. Didn't get to preach much. The Holy Ghost would just fall. And he come up that night and took me by the hand and said, I know I'm supposed to be out here doing something for God. And I took two other people and I said, let's agree that God would give him a sign. He said, I need a sign. Before God in heaven, he come back the next night and he had a blood cross appearing on his head. By the third night, that thing was a perfect blood cross. And we had more people coming with cameras to take pictures of him than come to hear me preach. Really, I told him, I said, y'all let me preach and take my offering. Y'all shoot all the pictures y'all want. Let me have a little part in this service, huh? Hallelujah. But God was doing things, and that voice come and said, the spirit of revival will leave. And you know, after you ain't going to stay nowhere no 7 months unless it's God. But you know what? I went out there that night, and the same peoples and crowds that, you know, we'd been having revival, I couldn't hardly get an amen out of them. I said, I'm going to try it one more night, tested spirits. Went out there, the same thing. Man, I shut that revival down. Hallelujah. But God told me, he said, when it returns, then give me a sign, and it's going to return. How many of you believe we're in time for revival right now? And God is getting ready to outpour, I believe, going to give us this latter rain outpouring of the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. But and don't spend this time just sitting around. You got to make things happen. How many of you know God told Joel, sanctify a fast, call a solemn assembly, gather the elders, lie all night between the post and the altar. Wouldn't hurt some of us to get in a little sackcloth and ashes. Hallelujah. Read Isaiah 58. All the things he said would happen if you do a little fasting and praying. Said your health would spring forth speedily. You know why? Because God knows when you fast and do it right, it pulls all that junk out of your body you've been packing in there for the last 2 years. Hallelujah. And helps your body. Got to get rid of all that poison. And your health will spring forth speedily. It'll be your real reward. He'll go before you. You can call and he'll answer. How many like to call to the Lord and have him answer? Hallelujah. Just raise your hand right now and say, Lord, help me to get in a fast if you want to. Lord, everybody got their hand right now raised. Lord, this kind of don't come forth by nothing but by prayer and fasting. And Lord, help them to get into it, Lord. God, a time of seeking you, Lord. Time of calling on your name, Lord. God, you can drop it. You dropped it in me so many times, Lord. God, drop it in my brothers and sisters that's wanting it. In Jesus' name. Amen. Hallelujah. I'm going to receive an offering tonight. If anybody want to help us, we've done since we've been here, had to send $350 to make them, to get that, get them started over there. Permits, $200. And brother took another $150 up there today for us to get the power pole set up. Man, I tell you, I hadn't even paid. I got a lot rent. It's going to cost me $400. But how many of you know one soul? Just one soul getting saved. That's what we do with our finances. We ain't laying up no treasures on the earth. If you got $100, anything you want to help us. Because, you know, with them people, if something happens there, how many of you know that y'all going to get the rewards of it? How many of you know without a preacher, they can't preach? And how can he preach unless he be sent? And tonight, if you want to help us and support us, anybody want to come stay with me, come on. I tell folks that all the time. I'll let you live with me for a few months. I guarantee at the end of a few months, you'll be, well, most time after a few weeks, you'll be wanting to go home and get in that comfortable bed. Hallelujah. I'm kind of like, I was fussing one time about it, and the Lord spoke to me, and Jesus said, I didn't have a place, I didn't even have a pillow. At least I got a pretty good pillow. Hallelujah. If you can help us tonight, stand with us and support us. I don't care. Ain't nothing too big or too small. Man, I tell you, I'm a help. I wish I had time. I've had so many visions and all started out. Brother Terrell had us praying all night long, almost 19 years ago in Macon, Georgia. And I told it a little bit the other night. After I went praying, I went back and I was staying in that little motel right down the street. When I shut the door before God in heaven, I'll stand before God is what I'm fixing to tell you. I ain't never had it happen since. My hand shut that door and something picked me up and levitated me. I know people think I'm crazy, but it don't bother me. And I floated over and laid down on the bed. When I went on the bed, I went into a vision and I saw my ministry in the last days. And I heard a voice ask me a question. And after that, the spiritual part, didn't know nothing. I went into a vision. I was in the vision. I saw a machine about this big. That high. Had a little metal look. It was white and had a little metal plate on it. It said champion. I knew it was a juicer. I didn't know nothing. Man, I was just as dumb as anybody. Appreciate that. And I come out of that vision, I was in the vision, and the second thing, I saw a bottle come tumbling out of heaven, stood before me and said, life fortune. Spun around and said, take three a day. After that, a green looking metal envelope come flipping. And it said, Sun Chlorella, and it flipped around and said, take 10 a day. I got up in church Saturday morning and told it. I hadn't had time to look at nothing. That must have been on a Thursday or Friday night. Before God in heaven, them girls got to doing all that phone work. Out of California, there's a machine called a champion juicer. I didn't know it. They ordered it and bought it. I keep it with me all the time. I don't go nowhere without it. Even in Old Mexico, I don't have that one, but we got them down there, keep them. And I told about the Life Fortune. They looked it up for a week. There wasn't no such thing. I told about the Sun Chlorella. Some of you may remember old Brother K before he died. He went running back to the back of the church. He had a bag back there, and he brought one out. He said, "Is this it?" I said, "That's it. Green and white, or green and metal, just like I told in the vision." We looked at it, and we flipped it around, and it said, "Take 10 a day, the little bitty things." They said, "Brother Barnhill, you got the Sun Chlorella and the Champion Juicer right." I said, "But you missed it on this Life Fortune." You know, for 2 years that stayed in the back of my mind. I thought, God, how could somebody get two right and have one wrong? That ain't, God, you don't miss things. 2 years later, I walked in a health food store, and there they was sitting on the shelf. Right down to the detail, the color, even told them it was green with a little brown thing. It said Life Fortune. Right down to the detail. I picked that thing up, man, I was shaking. I turned it around, said, "Take 3 a day." Man, I got that phone number off, called the company out of Tennessee up there. Talking to the man, he said, "You know, we had been praying for 2 years. Because, you know, most of that stuff you get in Walmart ain't nothing but fillers. All them health food stores." That's right. They even come out in the papers a year or so ago. And you know what? He began to broke down, shaking, crying, said, "You know, we've been praying for 2 years for God to give us something to help people." And that's the only reason I believe in it. I believe in them because of the vision. Hallelujah. God knows what my body, you pray and let God show you what your body needs. Thank you, Lord. Set your hand this way. Lord, we ask you to bless this offering. Lord, press it down, run it over. In Jesus' name. And you know, I've had over in, you know, God made the plants before he even put them in the earth. Read that over in Genesis chapter 2 and verse 4 and 5. Boy, you got a fistful. You must be Clint Eastwood. Before God put the plants in the earth, he made them. It's right there in the scripture. Read it. Ain't it? It's like you going some mater plants and go buying them from a farmer market or something. They already been raised, grow. That's what God done. Before he put the plants in the earth, he created them. And the Bible said he give us all these herbs. Give the cattle. I was in a health food store a while back. And you know, I don't fuss at nobody that eats beef, but I don't eat a whole lot of it, especially if it ain't organic. They said, "How you gonna get protein if you don't eat no beef?" I said, "You ever seen a cow sit down to a plate of meat?" She said, "You know, you're right, brother." I said, "I've never seen a cow sit down to a plate of meat." And they get all the green, all they get, everything they need right there in that grass, ain't it? And God knows what he was doing. Man's one that's kind of on the dumb side. Hallelujah. Don't you appreciate the Lord? I tell you, he's good. I'm going to get in some scripture, but this morning I was praying. Believe this or not, and if it ain't here, it will happen. And a black lady appeared to me. I was down on my knees, I guess in that chair there. Might have been in that, had it over here. Appreciate that chair, that's a lot softer. I like to sit and pray sometime. And a black lady appeared to me. I didn't see her face, but I looked up toward where she was. And I asked her, I said, "Ma'am, you fighting leukemia, ain't you?" She said, "Yes." I don't know if you're here tonight. I don't know where it was. I just know that somewhere it'll happen. And if you're here and you got leukemia, God's going to give you a miracle. I don't know who you are, but it will somewhere. It'll happen. It'll come to pass. Might be a year or two down the road. I don't know. But she was a black lady. If you're here tonight, if you'll come up here, God will heal you right now. I know. Man, I know God don't miss these things. Hallelujah. If you're here tonight, you got leukemia, fighting it. That's what I asked her. I said, "You fighting leukemia, if you'll just come up here tonight, God will give you a miracle." Hallelujah. I don't even know what leukemia, how it affects you. Anybody know? In your blood? Hallelujah. And if you hear and got that, if you'll come up, God will give you a miracle. Ain't nothing too hard for God. If it ain't here, it will be somewhere. Because God don't miss it. How many of you believe that? Hallelujah. And I appreciate the Lord. We're going to get in some scriptures in and talk to us a little bit tonight. I'll tell it in somewhere or another. God, it'll happen.
Thank you, Lord.
Lord, I appreciate this. It helps us, sustains us. Lord, you know my heart. In Jesus' name. How many of you tonight appreciate that service last night? And I tell you that, I'm going to keep my name in that book. How many of y'all going to keep your name in that book? But I want to go here to the book of Titus tonight, be the mind of the Lord. I'm always subject to Him. And right before you get to Hebrews over there, and I want to read a verse here in chapter 3 and verse 5. I want to read 4 and 5. But after that, the kindness and the love of God our Savior toward man appeared. He said, not by works of righteousness which we have done, but according to His mercy. How many of you know He had some mercy on us? Man, don't you know He was thinking about us when He let Jesus go to that cross? According to His mercy, has saved us by the washing of regeneration. And you know, Jesus told them apostles, said, you're going to sit with me and judge the 12 tribes of Israel in the regeneration. How many of you know that? And I'm looking forward for that. And renewing of the Holy Ghost, which He shed on us abundantly through Jesus Christ our Savior. Being justified by His grace, we should be made heirs according to the hope of eternal life. Father, I ask You to bless this word tonight, Lord. I'm just a vessel. Can't do nothing. Never will be able to. Let You do it through me. So speak to us tonight out of Your word. Lord, let Your word have liberty and free course. Lord, grant signs, wonders, and miracles to be wrought by the name of Thy Holy Child, Jesus. Lord, and I'll give You the praise and the glory. Amen. Now I want to talk here for a few moments tonight on the renewing of the Holy Ghost. How many of you know that's what we need right now? We need. Now, something that's renewed is something that's done been there. I call it restoring or renewing. How many of you know right now we need God to give us that refreshing? You know, the heavens must hold until the times of restoration. And we need a refreshing from His presence. You know, during the time up there in Alabama, North Alabama where we live, they've been in a kind of a drought. And, you know, our crops is a little bit behind y'all's because it stays cold up there longer. And yesterday they got, his wife was telling Brother Cloy, and some of them told me, we got a big garden up there and they plant me carrots and stuff like that. And he told me the other day, he said, we're in a drought, we need some rain. But yesterday they got some rain. You know what it done? It refreshed that ground. Man, all them old dried up looking weeds and grass out there. Matter of fact, a man called me today that mows our pasture and said we need a lawnmower. That grass is growing quick. Hallelujah. Just after that one little shower, that rain. How many of you know right now we need some spiritual rain? You know, Job spoke about the day that we're living in. And he said there would be a perplexing of the animals. I was raised on a cattle farm. My dad, you know, we raised cattle coming up, and my job was to feed them cows and milk. Anybody ever milked a cow before? You got to know how to do it. You don't just squeeze it. You got to, ain't that right? He had.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
Somebody would come around, I could hit them every time. But you know, during the winter time, we had hay for them, or feed for them. And if them cows was used to me coming out there about 4 o'clock or 5 o'clock in the evening, most time around 4 when I get in from school, If I was a few minutes late, you know what they do? They go running that fence line mowing. Let me know. Get out here and feed me, boy. How many of you know that's what us Christians need to be doing to us preachers? Get us some food. I was thirsty. You didn't give me drink. I was hungry. You didn't feed me. I was naked. You didn't clothe me. And I know he's talking about maybe, but how many of you know we need some food from heaven to be able to feed the people? We need some meat from heaven to be able to give them. Man, this is the most sickest generation you ever seen. The Bible said healing. Well, it don't say it, but how many of you know that woman said, Lord, I know I may not be worthy. And she said, but if I can just get a crumb. How many of you know healing is a children's bread? We need some bread from heaven, folk. We need some rains on this dried up generation right now. This generation is dried up. And we need a renewing of the Holy Ghost. You know, Peter spoke about the angels desired to look into it. They didn't have the Holy Ghost. The Bible said the prophets inquired about it. They didn't have the Holy Ghost. Because the Holy Ghost wasn't given to Jesus. Came. You know, he had it though. How many of you remember when he went to John the Baptist? The Bible said, John said, you baptize me. Jesus said, no, you do it for me. This is the way it's planned. John said, I have need to be baptized of you. Jesus said, suffer to be so, for thus it fulfills all righteousness. And the Bible said, and that's what I saw when I saw in that dream, I saw John baptizing Jesus coming up out of the water, and the Bible said the heavens was open. And the Spirit descended upon Jesus like a dove, and a voice spoke and said, this is my beloved Son in whom I'm well pleased. Hear. Hallelujah. On the Mount Transfiguration, he said, hear what he's got to say. But he said, this is my beloved Son. And the Bible said that immediately the Spirit, the Holy Ghost, drove Jesus. I don't understand this Holy Ghost we got. It drives us to the table. It's that Holy Ghost and fire, and it drives me to the table. Drives me to the table. Drives me to the table. It's that Holy Ghost and fire, and it drives me to the table at least three times a day. Somebody said, I don't eat but one meal a day from the time I get up to the time I go to bed. Boy, God wants to do something in this fasting meal in here tonight. Hallelujah. How many of you know the Spirit drove Jesus into the wilderness, into a time of not eating for 40 days and 40 nights? I don't know what's wrong with this Holy Ghost that we got that don't lead some of us, hallelujah, into a time of fasting, into a time of prayer. And it drove Jesus into the wilderness. Be tempted of the devil. Being the three temptations, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eye, and the pride of life. Hallelujah. Jesus returned, and I give the first night the vision that we had when I saw Jesus going up in that mountain and returning and saying, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me this day. And the Bible said he returned in the power of the Spirit. How many of you know Matthew 17? Jesus said this kind ain't going to come forth by nothing but what? Praying and fasting. I brought my son to thy disciples, the young man, the man said. He could not, they could not cure him. Later on, the Bible said they got Jesus alone and said, Lord, why couldn't we do it? He said, this kind can't come forth by nothing but by prayer and fasting. But John 16, Jesus said, it's expedient for you that I go away. If I go not away, the Comforter will not come. But if I go away, I will send him. Hallelujah. And when he comes, he'll reprove the world. Man, I want the kind of Holy Ghost that if I say something to somebody, I got to make it right. Yeah. I can't steal with this kind of Holy Ghost. Man, when I got saved, I'll tell you all a little something. I was raised in the country, and man, if we ate it, we just about got it. I was talking to a little brother right out there a while ago. He had some fish there. Somebody told him, said all these years, he looked like he was 60 years old, said mudfish. Said he'd been catching them, throwing them on the bank, but he said somebody told him to skin them. Said, and he showed him one, said, I'm going to take it home, cook it, and try it. Hallelujah. How many of you want to be a fisherman? I sure do. And when I was about 14, I'd been turkey hunting, and my daddy was a big turkey hunter in that part of the country, and a lot of people know him. And you can believe this or not, he killed 7 turkeys with 1 shot. Said, how in the world did he do it? He caught them running down a fence line, got the heads lined up, using them number 4 shots and a 12-gauge shotgun. And that's one thing about it. I told my daddy, I said, Daddy, I ain't never caught you in a lie, but I know you're alive. That's one thing about it, man. My daddy, his handshake was his word. Them old timers used to be like that. How many of you know what I'm talking about? Man, this younger generation, you got to get 48 copies, and it still ain't no good. Hallelujah.
That's right.
And I went turkey hunting, my daddy, you know, and somebody else had shot a turkey, and it went down there and died where I, you know, right down there beside me nearly. And I thought, man, alive. I think I'm going to trick my daddy. That thing had a beard about that long. Man, I throwed that old turkey over my shoulder, walked like he did when he come out of the woods, one of them old turkeys, you know. Hallelujah, walked right up where he was, and my daddy looked at that turkey, saw that beard, and said, son, I'm so proud of you. I thought, I think I'll wait and tell him later. Supper was ended, man, we eat that turkey, you know, and I thought I'll tell him, and I thought, man, my daddy was telling everybody already, calling, man, you ought to see what my boy done. He done killed a turkey, and it looked, I believe that beard was about 10 inches. Man, he was bragging on me all over the country, and I thought, oh, Lord, I think I'll wait a little bit longer and tell daddy. How many of you know we need a reprover? Man, some people look you right in the eye and lie to you and never even think nothing about it. Steal? Other month, I was in a store. I buy these vitamins and stuff and herbs, you know, occasionally. And main things I do is every day if I'm not water fasting, I try to take, you know, them two I saw in the vision. Anyway, and I went into the store, and they got a new cash register lady in there, and I told her I wanted some of them vitamins, and they were $7.99, and she charged me $1.99. You know what I done? I said, ma'am, give me about 10 of them boogers. She give me 10 of them. I've been buying them there. I got my vehicle, got about 5 miles down the road, something hit my heart. Man, I slammed on them brakes, went back. Went to that cash register lady. I said, ma'am, how much is them vitamins? She said, $1.99. I said, would you look real close? Did y'all reduce them things? Man, she looked at that price at 7. It turned into a 1. Hallelujah on that 1 that she looked at. But she looked at the rest of them, made $7.99. I said, ma'am, I just couldn't have no peace in my heart. I don't want to go to hell over a vitamin. She said, what you want to do? I done sold them. I said, well, just take out that amount that I got, and here's the rest of them, and give them back to you. Hallelujah. I said, man, you can't have no peace. You can't do people wrong when you got the real Holy Ghost. That kind of Holy Ghost, he said, would reprove the world of sin, righteousness, and judgment. Of sin because they don't believe on me on righteousness because they go back to the Father of judgment because the prince of this world is judged. And that time that I killed that turkey, and you know, and that was a summer before, or 2 before that, I really dedicated my life and went to the Lord. And you know, I stayed out of church just a couple of months and went back. That missionary come through there. And you know what? I started seeking the Lord for the Holy Ghost. Before God in heaven. Every night, just about for a week, I'd go to that church and I'd get down and say, God, I want to hear some tongues coming out of me.
Yeah.
I did. Gobble, gobble, gobble. I'd push it in the back of my mind, you know, thinking, Man, I go to the church the next night trying to pray through, saying, Lord, I want to hear some tongues. And all I could hear myself was gobble, gobble, gobble. Man, I fought that for about 4 or 5 nights, and finally, one night my daddy was working 3:11, and I thought, Lord, I got to get this thing out of me. And man, I before God in heaven, he got up to go to work. We standing there beside the fireplace. I said, Daddy, I need to tell you something. He said, what is it, son? I said, you remember that turkey I killed, had that 10-inch beard? He said, yeah. I said, and when I said that, my knot, that knot right there got big as my fist. You know what it was? It was a lying spirit in me. I said, he said, what is it, son? Man, big old tears started running down my eyes. I said, I couldn't get it out. He said, son, what's wrong? Man, I was a boo-hooing by that time and a squalling. Hallelujah. I said, Daddy, I didn't kill. I said, come out. Come out, you lying devil. I didn't kill that turkey. Hallelujah. I said, somebody else killed that turkey. And it went down there and died where I was. And I was going to tell you, Daddy, but I ain't got around to it yet. I'm getting around to it now. He looked at me and walked out the door. But you know what? That lying spirit was out of me. Hallelujah. You say, well, you do somebody wrong, you got to make it right, folks. You tell a lie, you got to make it right if you can. Hallelujah. We've all lied. Hallelujah. But there's a difference. He that maketh a lie. Liars, you're going to have their part in the lake of fire, the Bible said. Is that right? That those that make a lie, there's a difference in lying and making a lie. I made a lie. Oh, Lord. Boy, there must be a bunch of them in here tonight. Man, you got to straighten things up. I don't see how people can live. I can't live with myself. Even if I find it out later that I've told, I had to go to them and straighten it out. Jesus said it's expedient for you, and he'll reprove the world of sin, righteousness, and judgment. Hallelujah. He said when he comes, he won't speak of himself. Hallelujah. He'll only glorify the Father. How many of you know we need a Holy Ghost that don't talk about self? Hallelujah. We need a Holy Ghost that talks about God. We got too many preachers that talk about self all the time, trying to lift up self. This thing ain't about lifting up self. Jesus said, if I be lifted up, then I'll draw men unto me. We need a real outpouring of the real Holy Ghost. And Jesus said, it's expedient for you that I go away. If I go not away, hallelujah. And the last thing, just about, he told them disciples, he said, go back and tarry in Jerusalem until you be endued with a power from on high. Acts 1 and about 13, the Bible said he told them, hallelujah, and they went back and they was in what? Prayer and supplication. Prayer and supplication. John truly baptized you with a water under repentance, but you're going to be baptized not many days with the Holy Ghost and fire. I believe right now it ain't going to be long if God can find a people that's seeking him. He's fixing to give us them latter rains of the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. And the Bible said they went back, they was in prayer and supplication, and with one accord, Acts 2 said, hallelujah. You know what praying does? It brings you into the accord, with one accord, not everybody else's accord. Get in that mind of Jesus. Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus, who thought it not robbery to be equal with God. And the Bible said, suddenly there come a sound from heaven as a rushing mighty wind, and the house was filled. They saw the cloven tongues as fires that fell upon them. How many of you know that's what we need today, folks? We need some cloven tongues of fire. Hallelujah. And they began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. It wasn't them talking. History says there was over 50 countries there. Hallelujah. The Bible records 17 different nations, and they began to hear them speak in them dialects and them languages. You know, man used to be with one language. But during the days of Babel, they're going to build a tower up to heaven, and God confused their language. Didn't he? Can you imagine? Bring me a brick. Da 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 da. Make diga. Bring me a brick. Da 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 da. Bring me a brick. Da 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 da. I just prayed it. My wife and me had the same tongue. Me and my youngest had the same tongue. That's what God done. That language scattered them everywhere. Hallelujah. There was confusion. Hallelujah. That's been confusion ever since. But you know what's fixing to happen? God's fixing to take out this confusion. Hallelujah. Ain't going to be no confusion in the Holy Ghost. And we're going to be of one language. We might be speaking another dialect, but it's going to be one language. Hallelujah. It's going to be a language from heaven. Man, that thing got noise abroad after a while. Some of them said, this man,
These men are drunk. These women are drunk. Jesus' mother done got drunk. He done got some of that wine Jesus made them on the third day in the marriage of Cana of Galilee. Hallelujah. But Peter stood up and said, this is not, hallelujah, these men are not drunk as you suppose, but this is that was prophesied by the prophet Joel, that in the last days I'm going to pour out of my spirit. Hallelujah. I believe that we're living in that right now. Your sons and your daughters are going to prophesy. You old men are going to have dreams. Us young men, we're going to have visions. And upon my handmaids and my servants, I'm going to pour out of my spirit. And Peter said, the promise is unto you and to your children and even to them that's afar off out there. Hallelujah. The Holy Ghost took them over. They wasn't their own no more. Peter wasn't that man that denied Jesus. Hallelujah. When the rooster crowed, he was a changed man because he was filled with the Holy Ghost. I don't know about you, but we need another infilling of the Holy Ghost. How many of you out there need a change? Hallelujah. We need a change, folks. We ain't got the Holy Ghost. Our Holy Ghost don't measure like it did in the book of Acts that they had. Hallelujah. We need a Holy Ghost like Peter and John had. Hallelujah. After that they had healed that man at the gate of Beautiful, they throwed him in prison. And the Bible said they were praying and the house was shaken and they were refilled with the Holy Ghost. We need that kind of Holy Ghost that they had on the day of Pentecost. We need that kind of Holy Ghost that Peter went down and prayed for the crippled man at the hour of prayer. Hallelujah. And he was raised. We need that kind of Holy Ghost.
Hallelujah. Glory.
Something wrong with our Holy Ghost. Well, I got it. Sha-la-la-la-la-la-la. Same tongue you've been talking for 48, 28, 38 years. Same old tongue. Hallelujah. Man, I want to hear some real heavenly languages. I want the kind of Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. I don't know about this guy. Boy, I wouldn't want to be on the other end of the stick. But the Bible said, hallelujah, Barnabas sold some land, brought the price, laid it down at the apostles' feet. And there's a man by the name of Ananias and his wife Sapphira. Hallelujah. And they sold some land and brought the money in there. Ananias did and laid it down, acting like it was his own, everything that he had. Peter looked at him and said, why, you ain't lied to man, but you've lied to the Holy Ghost. You've lied to the Holy Ghost. And the Bible said the man fell down dead instantly. Oh, Lord, have mercy. Man, we think the Holy Ghost, it's real, folks. The Holy Ghost is God. It's a spirit. And he lied to the Holy Ghost and he fell down dead. 3 hours later, his wife come in from Walmart, the beauty shop. 4 bags of brand new clothes and brand new shoes and her toes painted up. Hallelujah, had a brand new hairdo. Thank you, Lord. Peter said, did y'all sell the land for such and such? Yeah, for such and such. Said, why have y'all conceived in your heart to lie? The men that just buried your husband 3 hours later, here they are right now, and they're going to bury you, and she fell down and gave up the ghost. Man, if we get this real Holy Ghost, you can't lie to it. That's the kind of Holy Ghost that we need, folks. Something that's real. I remember the time Brother Terrell told that man, you step over that cutout place where they had the water drainage, and he stepped over it and died right there. Hallelujah. That's the kind of Holy Ghost we need. That'll bring fear back into the house of God. This Holy Ghost we got now ain't no reverence in it. Hallelujah. That's where they get the word reverence, because they used to reverence God's men because they were so, and women, because they were so full of the Holy Ghost that sinners could get around them and they could feel that presence. We need that kind of Holy Ghost that Stephen's had in the 7th chapter of the book of Acts. Hallelujah. After that they were stoning him, and Peter, Stephen stood up, hallelujah, was telling them about their fathers and how that they were a bunch of hard-hearted men and they were stoning him. And the Bible said Stephen, being full of the Holy Ghost, he looked up and the heavens was open and he saw Jesus standing at the right hand of the Father. I mean, if you know, that's the kind of Holy Ghost that we need, that we can get them heavens open up. Jesus being baptized and the Holy Ghost descended and the heavens was open up. This kind of Holy Ghost we got nowadays, it don't open the heavens, church. We need to get our heavens opened up. Hallelujah. We need something to lead us into seeking God until we get a real outpouring of the Holy Ghost. You can have it. Don't wait on somebody else. You can have it.
Yes.
How many of you know we need it?
Yes.
We need a real outpouring. You know, the 10th chapter of the book of Acts. The Holy Ghost hadn't been given to the Gentiles yet. Just to the Jews. He came to his own. His own received him not.
Right.
But as many as received him, to them he gave what? Power, rights.
Power. Right.
The ability to become the sons of God. Hallelujah. They needed the Holy Ghost. Us Gentiles needed the Holy Ghost, didn't we? Hallelujah. God used the man to give it to him before that. You can't buy this real Holy Ghost. How many of you remember in the 8th chapter of the book of Acts? Hallelujah. When Philip went down to Samaria and preached Christ unto them, they gave the most earnest heed when they saw the miracles. Hallelujah. Man, if we can get these miracles going, the real Holy Ghost is going to cause these miracles to come in. When they saw the miracles, they gave the most earnest heed, but Philip wasn't qualified, so they called Peter and John. They come down there. Hallelujah. They laying hands upon the people. And the Bible said a man by the name of Simon come up there and said, I'll give y'all some money if y'all let me lay hands upon the people. And they received the Holy Ghost. Peter looked at him and said, this thing cannot be bought. Ain't enough money in the world to buy this Holy Ghost. We need a Holy Ghost that money can't buy. It. A Holy Ghost. Ain't enough money in the world. Walt, that man that built Walmart, he offered millions to somebody to be able to heal him of that cancer, but it couldn't be done because you can't buy the gift of God. Peter said, you're in the gall of bitterness, Simon, to think that this thing could be bought. Hallelujah. Ain't enough money in the world to buy what God wants us to have, but it's going to come through the price of fasting and praying, people. We need a Holy Ghost revival. We need an outpouring like they had in the book of Acts. Ananias went down there after that. Saul got off of his high horse. God needs to knock some preachers off of their high horse. Thought he was doing God's service, going down there killing, persecuting Christians. One day on the road to Damascus, a bright light shined upon him above the brightness of the sun about noonday. And a voice spoke to Paul and said, Saul, at that time, why persecutest thou me? Hallelujah. Saul said, what? Who are you, Lord? That's what us ministers and all of us in here tonight need to be doing, saying, who are you, Lord? We don't know him like we should, that I might know him, the power of his resurrection, the fellowship of his suffering, being made conformable unto his death. If we really knew him, he'd be talking to us every day, telling us what to do, telling us not what to do. The real Holy Ghost, it guides you into all truth, the Bible said in John, didn't it? Hallelujah. It'll guide you into the truth. How many of you know we need something to guide us? How many tired of making mistakes? Jesus had the Holy Ghost that he never made one mistake. He had the Holy Ghost that no matter who he prayed for, they never did not get healed. Every one of them got healed. He had the real Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. That no matter what he told them to do, it worked.
Yeah. Hallelujah.
Not no guesswork. This Holy Ghost we got is flip a coin. Most preachers pray, well, I go home and I'll pray with you. Man, I want to see a Holy Ghost if that miracle happens right there.
Amen.
Peter being full of the Holy Ghost, silver and gold have I none. Instantly that man, strength come in his legs and his ankles, and he jumped up like a deer. Hallelujah, 5,000 souls was instantly added to the church on that day. That's the kind of Holy Ghost I want. Don't you want that kind of Holy Ghost? Paul being knocked off that donkey or whatever he was riding said, who are you, Lord? He said, I'm Jesus of Nazareth. If you persecute, don't you know it's hard for you to kick against the pricks? Paul said, well, Lord, what would you have me to do? That means to be the sacrifice. You know, most preachers say, Lord, what would you have me to do before they know him? Got it backwards.
Right.
We don't need to get this thing backwards. We need to get it lined up right. Hallelujah. Paul went to that Arabian desert. Galatians 1 said, when it pleased God who separated me from my mother's womb, called me by his grace to reveal his son in me, immediately I what? Conferred not with flesh and blood. He went to that Arabian desert. Hallelujah. And the Bible said in the 13th chapter of Acts, after he come back and sat in Antioch with Barnabas for a year, the church began to pray. Everybody say pray.
Pray.
Not play, but pray.
Pray.
Hallelujah. And the Holy Ghost spoke. That's what we need today. We need the Holy Ghost to tell us what to do. And the Holy Ghost spoke and said, separate me, Paul and Barnabas, for the work that I've called them to do. If we get this Holy Ghost moving for us, it would tell us when to go, where to go, and how not to go. Hallelujah. If there's a time that we were supposed to go somewhere and it wasn't God's will, like Paul in the 16th chapter of the book of Acts, the Bible said that Paul made up his mind to go to Bithynia, and the Spirit, the Holy Ghost, said, why? Don't go. It suffered him not to go. Ain't you tired of making mistakes going to the wrong place at the wrong time? Well, if we had the real Holy Ghost, we'd never make a mistake. Hallelujah. It works when God takes you somewhere. It works when God is the author of it. When I was at the bench praying, how many of you know Sister Salden from Memphis, Tennessee? You know her. Most of you. And I went into vision. I saw one of her deacons. His hands outstretched to me and said, Brother Barnhill, come over to Memphis. We need you. Then I come out of it and I said, Lord, have mercy. Boy, it's a good feeling when you got that assurance, that faith. I come out of the vision. I said, Lord, I know this is you and I ain't going to worry about it. It's going to work. Before God in heaven, I went to Walmart. After service that night, and I was in Walmart, and Sister Rhodey called me. Some of y'all might know her. She said, Brother Barnhill, how you doing? I said, well, I'm doing all right. How you doing, Sister Rhodey? She said, I'm doing good. She said, look, why don't you come preach for us sometime? I said, well, you had to check with Sister Salden on that. Hallelujah. I said, well, she said, well, I'll tell you what, let me call you back in a few minutes. She called me back. She said, Sister Salden wants to know if you can be there Sunday week. I said, yeah, I'll be there. Never told her nothing. Hallelujah. Before God in heaven, I've had some good services before. Thank you, Lord. But I went out there Sunday week, and I got up to preach, and I preached and read a scripture or something coming through that ceiling up there like a white cloud. You couldn't contain them people for about an hour. Sister Salden got up two different times trying to do this to the people. There was a lot of young people up playing instruments and stuff. They was knocking them instruments all over the place. The Holy Ghost was falling because it was ordained by God. And there's been times that Brother Barnhill's went places, hallelujah, and had to shut it down. One time I let a preacher talk me going into Paris, Texas. Hallelujah. Man, I got there, I had one the first night, I think. Had two the second night. Hallelujah. That third day I went in that pine thicket. I said, God, what's wrong here? Something ain't right. Hallelujah. And a voice spoke to me down through them pines and said, unless the Lord build the house, they that labor, labor in vain. Hallelujah. I jumped up from there, went running back. I didn't have the Strong's Concordance. I went back and running. I said, I heard a voice and it said, unless God build the house, the labor's in vain. Hallelujah. They began to look it up about an hour later. A sister that was helping us found it in the book of Psalms. Unless God build the house. I said, well, God ain't building this house. We're taking this tent down right now. Hallelujah. It was Brother Barnhill instead of the Lord. How many of you know we need a Holy Ghost that would tell us where to go, when to go? We need a Holy Ghost that can tell us, I saw you before that Philip called you on the fig tree. We need a Holy Ghost, hallelujah, that can tell us, go into the city. You'll meet a man bearing a pitcher of water. He'll tell you what to all y'all to do. We need a Holy Ghost that can tell us, in 2 days the Son of Man going to be betrayed into the hand of sinners. It's kind of Holy Ghost we got right now. It's a stupid Holy Ghost. Wow.
Come on now.
It's dumb. Can I get an agreement? Well, should I go or should I not go? Let me flip a coin. The kind of Holy Ghost that God wants us to have, you don't have to try the spirits. You'll know the spirits.
That's right.
Hallelujah. Man, we need a Holy Ghost like they had. Thank you, Lord. And to get this, it's going to take the same thing in Acts 10 over. The Bible said there's a man by the name of Cornelius. And the man served God day and night in prayer and feasting and fasting. Hallelujah. At a certain time of the day, there appeared unto him an angel of God and said, Cornelius, what's come up? Your prayers have come up. I want you to send down there to Joppa. There's a man down there by the name of Simon Peter. He'll come and he'll tell you what you ought to do. Hallelujah. Three men, Cornelius, sit down there. They got down there the next day. Peter was waiting on the Spirit to direct him. He just got all of that city saved. Raised that girl from the dead. Everybody in there just about got saved. He said, Lord, where do I go next? That's what he was doing on that housetop. He was praying, Lord, where do I go next? These preachers nowadays, you know what their thought is? Where can I go and get a big offering?
Yes, that's true.
Well, y'all know preachers, don't you? Where can I go and get the biggest finances at? Who's the rich people in that city? Hallelujah. You just tell somebody you went to a city and got blessed. That phone will be ringing off the hook. Hallelujah. You want to keep a preacher up? Tell them it probably ain't no offer, but you can come on anyway.
Come on now.
I'll call you back later. I want to find out if I let me pray a little harder. Hallelujah. How many of you know if it's God, it don't make no difference? Hallelujah. God knows how. Hallelujah. If it's God, if he has to take a few fish and a few loaves of bread, he can turn them into feed the multitudes. If it's God, he can take a little water and turn it into wine. If it's God, we need a Holy Ghost and we know that God's inside of it. We need the mind of Christ, folks. And what we got, it just ain't lining up with what they had in the book of Acts. And Peter was up there praying on the housetop, not sunbathing, but praying.
Hallelujah.
Hungry. Had to be fasting because he was getting hungry. Where do I go next, Lord? And the sheet was let out, knit at the four corners. And a voice spoke and said, Peter, rise and eat. Rise and eat. Peter said, Lord, ain't never ate nothing common unclean ever went in my mouth. Hallelujah. Done it the second time, the third time. I'm going to tell you how the Holy Ghost really moves. Hallelujah. About that time, he went into a trance and the Holy Ghost said, there's three men down at the gate right now. Don't question, just go with them. Peter looked over that wall and there was three men down there. Hallelujah. He said, for what intent of you? What are y'all doing here? And they began to tell it. Hallelujah. Peter kept him overnight. Him and six more men and them three, 10 of them. They went back to the house of Cornelius. And when they got there, Cornelius fell down at his feet. Peter said, stand up. I'm a man just like you are, Cornelius. God ain't no respecter person. Hallelujah. Let me tell you. God will move for anybody that will fast and pray and pay the price. We need a real Holy Ghost outpouring. And they got it just like they did in the second chapter of the book of Acts. They was in prayer and supplication. Cornelius, your prayers has come up. 4 days ago under this very hour, I was in fasting and praying. And a man stood before me in bright shining clothes and told me what to do. And we're all here waiting to hear what you got to say. And Peter began to preach how that God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Ghost and fire, hallelujah, power, who went about doing good, healing all. That was the press to the devil. We need the real Holy Ghost, folks. I ain't saying you ain't got a little bit of it, a little measure of it. I want to see the fullness of the Holy Ghost come in. I want to see God moving on his men and women with the kind of Holy Ghost that they had in the book of Acts. That chapter 20 and verse 28, it said it'll make us overseers. The Holy Ghost made them overseers. Separate me, Paul and Barnabas. I've got a work for them to do. How many of you want the real Holy Ghost? If you do, I want you to stand to your feet right now. Get them hands up and say, Lord, give me the Holy Ghost that measures up to what they had in the book of, Lord, in the book of, Lord, the book of Acts, Lord. God, let me measure up to that Holy Ghost. Lord, you said you wasn't going to put this new wine in old bottles, Lord. We're going to have to become new vessels, Lord. God, give us a real Holy Ghost. The real Holy Ghost. Lord, the real Holy Ghost. Lord, give it to us. Lord, the kind of Holy Ghost that they had in the book of Acts. I'm sick of this old Holy Ghost, Lord, that I've got. Lord, I'm sick of this old Holy Ghost. Lord, that half does, Lord, the work, Lord. The real Holy Ghost don't make mistakes. It don't go anywhere, Lord. God, that it ain't supposed to. Lord, it's a real Holy Ghost. Lord, give it to us. Give it to us tonight, Lord. God, the real, real, real Holy Ghost, Lord. God, help us tonight, Lord. God, to get the kind of Holy Ghost that lines up with the book of Acts, Lord. The real Holy Ghost, Lord, it lines up with apostles. Oh God, it lines up with what you had. Oh God, Lord Jesus, when John baptized you, you coming up out of the water, and the Holy Ghost opened and spoke and said, this is my beloved Son in whom I'm well pleased. God, give us that kind of Holy Ghost. Oh God, that we can have it. Lord, we ask this tonight, Lord. God, we decree it to be so. How many of you want this Holy Ghost? Hallelujah. You know what I'm going to do? I'm going to lay hands on you. Wow. Maybe the guitar player and the drum player and get on back up here. Hallelujah. And we can sing something. Hallelujah. How many of you know that song? It's a Holy Ghost and fire. And it's keeping me alive. Do you want the real Holy Ghost? Hallelujah. I'm going to ask God to put something in you tonight that'll make you seek for the real Holy Ghost. I'm not saying you ain't got a portion of it. I ain't saying you got a little bit of it, but I want the real Holy Ghost that lines up with what they had in the scriptures on the book of Acts. Lord, right now, Jesus, everybody we touch tonight, Lord, I ask you to give them the real Holy Ghost. Lord, the Holy Ghost, Lord, God, it lines up, Lord, with what they had, Lord, in the book of Acts. Lord, we decree it to be so. In Jesus' name. Oh, is that Holy Ghost of fire keeping me alive?